Thank you for listening to the BJJ Brick Podcast. We'll be bringing you Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and good times. We hope to flatten your Jiu-Jitsu learning curve, help you get the most out of your grappling ability, and meet your goals both on and off the mat.
Welcome back, my friends, to episode 215 of the BJJ Brick Podcast. You know, we've made a little change this week. Normally, we have the dynamic duo. Myself is the dynamic part, and Byron's the duo. This week, we have the three musketeers. We do have Joe Thomas, our friend who, does all the, does a lot of writing for us, does a lot of content on our Facebook page. He's been on a couple other times, and as our surveys have shown, he's the most popular out of us three. But definitely Joe is here today. How you doing, Joe?
I'm doing good, Gary. How are you?
Oh, doing great. Doing great. And we have Byron here as usual. Boo.
You call me the dude this episode, Gary. Because this episode is called The Big Lepointski. It's a play on words about the great movie The Big Lebowski. Is that one of your favorite movies, guys?
I have never seen it.
I looked it up on Wikipedia.
Oh, Joe's ahead of me.
Man. Oh, about a third of the audience is saying, dang, they need to see that movie. And the other two thirds have no idea. It's one of my favorite movies. It's like an outrageous comedy by the Coen brothers. There's three main characters. The dude, Walter, and Donnie.
Can I be Walter?
You could absolutely be Walter. And
I think I need to know more about the characters before I pick one.
Well, Donnie actually dies.
There you go.
Yep, I'm Walter.
Gary. Oh, man. But they are three lovable kind of losers that bowl a lot and are presented with a big problem. And it has nothing really to do with this episode. We're talking about point-based tournaments versus submission-only tournaments and some differences today.
Yeah, going to be a great episode. As always, this is the end-of-the-month episode where we don't have an interview. But Joe, myself, and Byron, we are going to talk about submission-only versus point tournaments. So going to be a good time.
Right on. I'm looking forward to it, guys.
To kick things off, if you have liked us on Facebook, you have inevitably seen some of Joe's posts on there. He's always posting like quotes and pictures and just interesting things that make you think about jiu-jitsu in a different way. Joe's got a quote this week. What do you have for us, Joe?
Yeah. Calm seas and safe harbors never produce skilled sailors. And I don't know who said that originally, but I'll buy it. What do you think, Gary?
You know, I like it. Yeah, we have to get put into some precarious positions to get better. Let's translate it to jiu-jitsu. I can train with the worst person I know, Byron, and, constantly, and I'm not going to get any better. You know, I have to go with, people like Joe, who's going to put me in a lot of bad positions, a lot of precarious positions, smash me, take my back. And basically, I have to go against those people to become a good jiu-jitsu person, to become a good sailor. I have to, go through some, rough seas, high waves, make the boat rock, and, to become better.
Yeah, Roger that.
At the time, it may not be that much fun, but it makes you a great sailor.
Yeah, I would think it goes well with this episode as well, because I would say tournaments is sort of a way for a jiu-jitsu player to step out of his comfort zone, to get out of that safe harbor, so to speak, and try something different, something unknown.
Oh, I like it.
Yeah, that's why we need to have Joe on the show. He actually brings stuff that means something to the show where, Byron and I, that we would have never caught that one. So thank you, Joe.
I just pulled that out of my hat 5 minutes ago.
I like it, though. I like it. That's a great quote, not just for jiu-jitsu, but, life. Get outside your comfort zone. We all kind of go through, the same steps every day. A lot of times we don't want to get out of that comfort zone. It, makes us sweat. It makes us nervous. It's scary. But putting yourself out there, you're going to learn a lot about yourself, and you're just going to get better at everything you do doing that.
Yeah, that's good point, Gary. And it's about making yourself work a little bit differently or harder and getting better at jiu-jitsu. Also, like to mention, this would be a good segue from that. There's more than one way to push yourself other than just tournaments and going out and competing. I have an audiobook called 6 BJJ Training Games, and they're designed to do the same thing, to push you out of your normal comfort zone, to make you do something a little bit different and really force you to learn and grow on the mats. And these are the 6 games that I play a lot while I'm rolling, and I've really been avoiding the plateaus and also the valleys, and have been on a gradual increase in what I feel is getting better at jiu-jitsu. There's 6 different games you could play with people while you're rolling, and they really don't even need to know you're doing this. You could tell them that's perfectly fine, but they just give you some limitations. They give you different goals while you're rolling, and they really just push you in different areas of your own game and make you explore what's a good transition or a good place to go from where you are now. So it really help you explore your own game.
Hey, Byron, you remember how long ago you sent me the advanced copy of that?
Oh, it was shortly before it came out. I had you check it out and make sure that it was acceptable. Maybe, was it 6 months or 3-4 months ago? I don't remember when it came out.
Three or 4 months. I've been going left ever since.
Oh, you mean as your passing guard?
Yes. Yeah, that was one of your games in there, and I've been trying to do everything left-handed ever since.
Nice. How has it changed something?
Well, it's making a difference, and as I've gotten more comfortable in top position from the opposite side, I'm finding that my training partners don't have as many answers. They're not used to people going that direction.
That's a good point. So this one I largely developed with Gary. If I pass Gary's guard and I end up on his right side, he underhooks and he escapes. Pretty much as soon as it happens, he's gone. But actually, if I pass to the other side, he has a little bit of trouble escaping sometimes, Gary. Isn't that right?
Yeah, and I remember about when you started passing the other side. And, Byron's playing the game on me passing the other side, but it's also a value to myself. I am not as good when somebody passes to that side. And by you doing it all the time, I hope you have seen I've got better on that side. And I now work it a lot more, when I'm rolling with people just to get better at that side. So the cool thing about, that game, like Joe was talking about, going to your opposite side, it doesn't just make you better. It makes your training partner better because you're forcing them into a different, avenue also. So, as your room gets better, everybody in your room is going to get better, and it's just going to, up the level of your team.
Damn, team player, Gary.
You got it, Joe.
Yeah, that's...
But I did hate it when Byron started doing that. It forced me out of my comfort zone, just like, we were talking about on the quote. It did. I didn't like it. It was something different, and I didn't feel in control.
Yeah. Gary was really in rough seas, typically noted from the cross faces I would do to him.
Yeah, and those rough seas really upset my stomach. And one time I did make a mess on Byron. I didn't mean to.
Oh, man. Yep. Gary, you always change the element slightly.
I'm known for taking this way off the bow.
Man, you're keeping it on the boat this time, though, Gary.
Byron, walk the plank.
Oh, man. So we have a little bit newer segment here, and Joe did such a great job with the quote. I think we'll have Joe take a swing at the off-the-mat lessons. So this is when we talk about an off-the-mat lesson and bring it to the mats and what we could learn from that. What do you have for us, Joe?
Yeah, so you guys know that Hurricane Harvey came through, and my home was flooded, and I've been spending a considerable amount of time cleaning up, tearing out walls, tearing out flooring. And there was a point where I had pretty much the contents to my entire house in a big heap outside in my front yard. And I'm trying to clean it up, and I've got to call contractors. I've got to call somebody to come get rid of the debris. I've got flooring yet to rip up. I've got to call FEMA. I've got to call the insurance. I've got 50 things to do. And I kept bouncing from one task to the other, thinking this can't be the most important thing that needs to be done now. But some of the things that needed to be done required permits, required other people to be available, required rental tools. And it occurred to me midway through that sometimes the thing that can be done right now is more important than the more important thing that can only be done later. Does that make any sense? How's that for a quote, guys?
You know, that is a great quote. I it does make sense. And I think about that. I run into that daily at work. You know, I have a lot of stuff that, you know, I kind of like you. I mean, I'm having a lot of stuff thrown at me. But some of the stuff, not necessarily waiting for permits. I'm waiting for, you know, somebody to sign off on something. I'm waiting for somebody to get out of a meeting where I can, get that approval. And, you know, I've just got all these things coming at me. I feel like I'm in a game of Space Invaders. But a lot of that stuff, it's like, let's don't even bother with it now. I can't attack it now. You know, I don't have so-called permit. I don't have the correct tool yet. So, I'm going to take care of what's in front of me that I can take care of right now and, you know, get it off my task list.
Exactly. If you've got one job you can be doing, put all your focus in that and worry about the other tasks when the time comes.
And that is definitely awesome.
Yeah, well said, Joe.
I can also bring this to my work. If I'm driving the fire engine, it's maybe not one job you can be doing. What's the next job that I should be doing? So if I'm driving the fire engine, we show up at a house fire. The first job is to get a charged hose line to the fire. So no matter what else is happening, that's really my goal as an engine driver, to help get that line in service and get that going, barring a few other things if someone's hanging out the window and that sort of thing. But 99% of the time, charge hose line to the fire. What's next? There's a lot of things that could happen next. The next thing is I need to get a water supply, get to a hydrant and get water so I don't run out of water. Get that one done. What's next? There's a lot of things you can do from there. But really the next thing is to get a second line in case something happens to the first line. So you have two hoses ready to go. And it's just, you've got to do them in that order, and they all need to be done. There's 100 other things I could do instead, but those are the main things that I need to do first. And just focus on what you can do, focus on what you should do.
Byron, I have a question on that. This is actually a legitimate question. I'm not going down a path that you probably don't want me to go down. But I always hear about if a car or a truck is parked in front of the fire hydrant, that you will break the windows and put the hose through the vehicle. Have you had to do that in your career as a fireman?
No, I would love to get that opportunity, but I have not.
Is it really done, or is that kind of like, do you just go over the vehicle if somebody's there, or would you really go through the windows?
It would probably be, depending on the vehicle, it'd probably be easier to go over, possibly under if it's depending on how the setup is and how high the vehicle is. But if that's the only option to go through the window, absolutely, I'm going to get water to the guys that, because once they get in that house, if they're in a house that's really burning and they run out of water, that's immediately a life threatening situation. So really, you do anything you can to get that water hooked up before they run out. And I'm not going to knock on someone's door to ask them to move their car. I don't have 30 seconds. So yeah, that would be one that I would absolutely do. It wouldn't be if there's an easy way around that and I didn't take it, I'd have to be in a bit of trouble. But that's an option.
Your number one goal, no matter what you have to do, is, you know, stop that fire, save people, and, you know, protect property.
There you go.
I guess I'm not a fireman, but that's what I'm thinking.
Life and property.
Yep.
That order.
Yeah. But you do have to watch The Backdraft.
That's true.
And I know your backdraft. You have seen that movie, huh? Bad. Your backdraft is pretty bad, Byron.
You haven't seen The Big Lebowski, but you've seen The Backdraft movie, huh, Gary?
Yep. Yeah, I have. 3 or 4 times, Byron.
There you go.
Does this lesson relate to jujitsu, guys?
No, I just saying.
Is that what we're here to talk about?
Okay.
One of Gary's favorite moves is called Backdraft, and man, it's awkward.
It is definitely awkward. It didn't make the cut for Byron's 6 games for BJJ. I tried to get it in there, but it didn't make the cut.
It made the cut for Gary's audiobook, 3 Things That'll Get You Sued Off the Mat.
3 Things That'll Get Your Arm Broken.
But yeah, this whole idea of do what you need to do now, or do what you can do, or do what's available now, same thing in jiu-jitsu. it could be anything from while you're rolling or while you're training. If you're here training and you got the world's best armbar guy here, you should be trying to get your armbar to be better or learn as much as you can about that. If you're rolling, you're stuck in mount, you should try to escape. You shouldn't be, you know, your head shouldn't be somewhere else. You shouldn't be trying to, you know, work on their elbow to kind of do a straight arm lock with your head and shoulder. You need to be doing what you need to do when you're in those spots.
Yeah, what if you're training for a no-gi submission-only tournament and you show up and it's a gi class and the technique of the night is spider guard?
That's a good one.
It doesn't help. You know, it's still going to help you for your tournament, even if the technique is spider guard. I mean, it's not necessarily applicable to what you're going to be doing in no-gi, but, you know, I look at it. I'm still rolling. We're going to be rolling, you know, after class. You know, people are going to be trying to go, you know, spider guard, not after class, but during class, after the technique portion. But, you know, I just look at it, rolling's rolling. You know, I'm going to learn something, you know, maybe a little bit of pressure, you know, balance, all sorts of things. Cardio, my cardio is going to be taxed. My grip strength is going to be worked. The spider guard may not be totally applicable, but, you know, I'm rolling. It's going to help me.
Yeah, it's the thing that can be done now. So it just makes sense to put your focus on that and worry about your no-gi training. Like you said, after class, there's time to roll. Yeah. There's other times.
I like that, Joe. I didn't get where you're going. It goes right back to the quote. You know, let's do what can be done now. I can train now. Perfect.
The quote was about the ships in the harbor, Gary. The life lesson is about...
quote, life lesson, they're all the same.
It's a highly quotable life lesson, though.
Yeah.
And that's a good point, Joe. Do it. I mean, it's a super common thing. Let's say, you know, you're basically working on your guard and you're really fine-tuning that and getting that the best it can. And you come in today and they're showing mount stuff. Do what you could do now. What is that? Mount. And really get the most out of the class. And when it comes time to roll and you want to go back to your guard and work on that, that's great. But don't just zone out mentally because this doesn't really apply to your game at the moment. You still need to learn about those techniques. Even just from a defensive point of view, if someone's going to get mad on you, you need to know what they're going to try to do to be offensive. Joe, that was I like the life lesson. You did great. Joe is kicking butt here, and
despite Gary's efforts to drag us off course.
I think that wraps up the beginning part of the show, and now we get to talk about the Big Lepointski or submission only tournaments or points based tournaments. And really where they're going, what's happening, and maybe some advice for training for one or the other and what could be done. And just to me, jiu-jitsu was gi-based. And then there came along no-gi. And it was everybody from the gi transitioned to a lot of people, not everybody, but a lot of people went from gi to no-gi. And it was really people that were just able to do both. Now we're seeing people that are just specializing in no-gi, and they're really excelling very well at that. You still have a lot of transition and people that could do both. And then a new element is submission only. And it's kind of like a separate sport, and much like the way that gi and no-gi are separate, very similar, but they're separate. So I think that as we progress in the future, you know, clearly, I don't think point-based jiu-jitsu matches or no-gi matches are going to go anywhere. They're still going to be here. And I think that submission-only stuff is here to stay as well.
Yeah, I really can't see one or the other leaving. It does seem like there has been a big popularity surge in submission-only. You know, I do think it has a lot to do with, you know, the coverage, you know, EBI and, you know, Metamoris, you know, originally, you know, are getting Fight to Win. So, you know, I think there's just, you know, a bigger market. People are seeing it more, you know, I think a lot of people like to see submissions. So I do think they're both going to survive. I just see jiu-jitsu growing. I don't think one's going to, you know, not do as well. I just see them, you know, both gi, no gi, submission, you know, points. I just see everything growing, and that's what I hope happens.
You know, guys, I competed in my first no-gi submission. They called it submission only, a submission tournament, almost 12 years ago. So I'm not sure really how new it is. But check out this point system or this method of determining a winner and see what you think. It was a round-robin tournament, and everybody in each division grappled everybody. So if there's five guys in your division, you would grapple four times. They were, I want to say, six-minute matches, so they're pretty short. But if you submitted your opponent, you got 5 points. If you fought to a draw, you each got 1 point. And, of course, the loser got 0 points. And then after all the matches were done, they totaled up the points, and the guy with the most points won the tournament.
I like that. I have seen that before. I really do like it. You're really rewarding the submission with 1 point. The draw, nobody wins. You know, you didn't get submitted. You stayed in it the whole 6 minutes. You still get a point. And, you know, you lose. You know, did you really lose? You showed up for the tournament and you learned. You get zero. I like those. I like that. You know, 6 minutes, you got to work hard to try to get that 5 points. And let's say you're really outclassed. You know, those 6 minutes are going to, you know, feel like an eternity of you defending subs, you know, trying to get the, you know, the 1 point for the draw. I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, I like the round robin format because you know you're going to get several matches.
Yeah, and you've got everybody. It's, you know, you're going through a bracket. You know, you may somehow all the good better people may have got put in one side, and you know they all knock each other out, and you come out the other side, and you know there's a chance you didn't go against the best, or did the best really win? But that way, there, you know, you're going against everybody. Nobody. Nobody hides. You have to run through the gauntlet. You have to take each and every person and, you know, get on the mat with them.
Yeah. And I think I've done a submission only style of tournament, and I don't remember if it was round robin, but there were a lot of matches, and I think it was when I was probably purple belt range. And it was similar. It seemed like, you know, just because, I don't know how many matches there were, but that seemed like a lot, and it seemed like a long day of competing, but just kind of felt like I was just going to roll with everybody and see how it went from there. You know, they're different though. And I think when people sign up for one of these, I think they're a little more optimistic as far as I'm going to tap somebody out. I think it's a bit of a thing where, you hear people saying that when they sign up for even a points tournament is, I'm not worried about the points. I'm just going to submit all the guys I roll with. And I don't know if you're playing the right game when you enter into a typical tournament that has points and you're not really worried about the points at all. It's great to submit everybody you roll with, but that may not happen, especially if you get somebody who's actually better than you at jiu-jitsu. They may be pretty hard to submit. They may not be impossible to beat. You might get a quick guard pass and maintain it for a little while, and they might recover and maybe even sweep you. And so it'd be 3-2. You could beat them in that situation, but are you going to really submit somebody who's better than you at jiu-jitsu? It's pretty tough.
Yeah, you know, definitely tough, but I do like that attitude. I think of jiu-jitsu as a submission-based martial arts. You know, I know there's points to go through it. I know, you know, we talk about, you know, the top pressure, you know, being able to control people, having their back. You know, it's a great art. You know, you can really mess with somebody's mentally when they can't move. You know, you feel like you're in a straitjacket. Byron or Joe got my back. You know, they got a hold of, you know, I can't move. It's a scary feeling. And you know, you can win like that. You're going to mess my head up. I'm going to waste all my energy trying to get out. But when I think of jiu-jitsu myself, you know, and I know everybody's got little different definitions of jiu-jitsu, but I think of jiu-jitsu is, hey, it's submission. Let's go for the submission. And, you know, I do believe that, you know, the control and position is great, but, you know, I do think the number one goal is submission. And I do like, you know, somebody who says, hey, I'm going to go out there and try. And it may not be the best idea. Like you said, Byron, if you let somebody pass your guard because, you know, it puts them in a better position that, you know, maybe you can take the back or, you know, swing into a Kimura, there's a good chance, you know, you just lost some points. That guy's going to stab the side mount and you may never get out again. So I don't think, I don't know if it's necessarily the best idea, but I think, in my opinion, that's the goal, you know, of jiu-jitsu is to, you know, take somebody's arm home and put it on your mantle.
Yeah, I've heard two things in the last year regarding training for tournaments with points that I don't 100% agree with. They kind of concerned me a little bit. And one was, I was told by an instructor that when they sweep their opponent, they like to allow their opponent to catch their leg, their foot, kind of in a quarter guard, half guard scenario, so that then they can get points for sweeping and passing the guard. And they said when they're in side control, they never just do a reversal. They always go for regaining at least half guard and then sweeping, because that's how you get points. And for me, if I'm sweeping my opponent, if I get caught in guard or half guard, then so be it. But ultimately, my goal is to get to a dominant position as quickly and efficiently as I can. So if I'm inside, if I'm bottom side and I can reverse you without regaining guard first and just go from bottom side to top side, that's what I personally am going to do. I know I miss out on some points, but that's my preference. And I think if there's a shortcoming to training for points only, I think that's it.
I agree with you wholeheartedly, right there, Joe. It's I want to get the best position, and I probably don't think about points enough, you know, which, you know, I guess could hurt me in a points tournament. But I think I got a better chance, like you said, of sweeping and get to a dominant position, you know, just get my sweep points, and then, you know, I end up in side control and really establish heavy hips, you know, block the hips and then start going for a submission. That's exactly like my mindset. It's like, let's get a submission. If I get caught, you know, in half guard, quarter guard, you know, man, now I got to pass that thing. Maybe while I'm passing, you know, I get caught in a, you know, who knows? I get, you know, something happens. I just want to, like you said, get to that dominant position and then, you know, bring the offense. As I say, as soon as I get dominant position, bring the pain. Let's work something.
Gary says it all the time. you make a good point about, you know, let's say I sweep somebody and I purposely let them get quarter guard on me. And then with the idea that I'm just going to slice right through that, that idea might backfire, because quarter guard may not be the strongest of guards for most people. But let's just say the guy shimmies under for deep half and I get swept before I even get my sweep points. I'm right back on my back. I did that to myself. Like, I put my foot in his quarter guard on purpose. Like, I think it's a smarter play to establish what you, it's kind of like you said earlier about the lesson of the day. Like, do what you can now. If you could pass his guard, pass his guard. If you could sweep him completely. If you could sweep him right in the mount, perfect. Don't sweep him into almost the mount with a quarter guard. Take what you can. And I think that that's not a wise move to give your opponent a little something to work with when you're almost to the point where if you had mount or you had the sweep fully locked in, they would be in a ton of trouble. You're trying to, it's like you're risking it all to get a little bit more. Take what you have.
Yeah. Yep. Take what you got. Take what's right in front of you.
Stepping over a dollar to pick up a dime.
Yeah. Man, Joe, that could be our quote next week. I like that. Yeah, you've got the big dollar bill right in front of you, but we're going to take the dime.
So I think a lot of what's happening with the submission only stuff is it's maybe a little easier of a sell as far as people to watch and attract an audience. Would you guys agree to that?
You know, I do like to watch submissions, but one thing I don't like is it just seems like there's a little more guard pulling. I think to really make the sport better, I mean, I don't know better, but I just see a lot of people who aren't totally familiar with jiu-jitsu, haven't been playing, you know, been doing this a long time. And, you know, they just see a bunch of guard pulling and, you know, butt scooting and everybody, you know, working for leg locks off their, you know, off their butt. It's not the, for the person who doesn't train, you know, I hate to say uneducated, but I don't think they like it as much. You know, I think they like to, I mean, not that there's not guard pulling in, you know, with the gi, but it just seems, you know, a big emphasis on pulling guard and, you know, trying to entangle a leg.
Do you guys have a fight to win up where you guys are? Are you familiar with that promotion?
Yes. Yep. Man, that promotion is doing great. Really doing awesome.
I like that. And I like the way they use the three judges to determine a winner of a fight when it's over. Yeah, so you might not get the submission, but if you're able to dominate the match, then you get the win. And I think out of all of the systems, that's my favorite right now.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. You know, and I was just reading an article before we came on here by our buddy who's been on the show, Josh Hinger. And he was talking about, you know, submission-only tournaments versus, you know, points tournaments. But, you know, I liked one thing he said is he said – and I hope I don't get this wrong. I'm trying to quote Josh, but he said something like, even if there's no points, like let's say it's a no points tournament, everybody in the audience kind of keeps points or keeps who's winning. You know, it's like, let's say all three of us are a judge. It's kind of like what Fight to Win does. See, you know, people are watching, you know, everybody has in their head, oh, and it's not necessarily just based off of submissions. It could be positional dominance. You know, Byron, you're more of a positional dominance person than me. I'm more of the person who goes for submissions. So, like, maybe I'm looking at somebody who attempted more submissions but was positionally dominated. But I'm thinking, hey, this guy put out more submissions. He won, even though it's a submission-only tournament. Joe and Byron, you know, they just, you know, smash you. They're smashers. They're grinders. They thought the other guy won because he dominated. At the end, we go to the judges, and my guy loses, and your guy wins. But I thought Josh made a good point just saying that even when there's no points, people watching are picking a winner. You know, they're saying, you know, somebody won based off of something, you know. And I never really thought about that. But when I'm watching, even if it's a draw, I may think, you know, hey, somebody did better. And so I do like what Joe was talking about, the judges at the Fight to Win.
Even when you're watching, yes. Even when I'm rolling, if I don't get submitted and I'm not keeping track of points, I get down and say, man, I got my butt kicked that round. You know, like, I know what happened. I don't have to have points to tell me this, or I don't have to have get tapped out that round. You just know it. And clearly, you know, when you feel that, any judge would have also agreed as well.
You know, sometimes when I roll, I'd rather get submitted than positionally dominated for, you know, 5-10 minutes. Because when I get up, I'm just exhausted, and basically I was like a rag doll out there. Somebody just did whatever they wanted to me. And, you know, the good thing is, at least if I get submitted, we start again on the feet, and I got a chance not to get back into that position. But, I always know when somebody just, they may not have got the tap, but, you know, hey, you beat me up bad. I haven't been beat up that bad in a long time. You know, good job.
Don't you hate it when you're getting wrecked and they just won't take the submission? You're
like, it's like,
here's my arm, man.
And you never want to quit due to exhaustion. You know, you've got broken mentally and you're just exhausted. And you just want to quit. And you're like, please take something. Please just let me get off this mat. I don't want to roll with you anymore. You're too good and you broke me.
Yeah, you just get off me and take the dang submission and let's be done with this thing.
Yeah.
I think there's somewhat of a movement, maybe in some people's opinion, that they want to see matches in the submission, that's a better match. And I don't necessarily agree with that 100%. Sure, great matches often end in submissions, but, you know, if you pair one of us up with one of the great people on the mats, they're going to tap us out pretty much right away, and it won't be a great match, but there'll be a submission. It's just a mismatch. Anytime you get like a big mismatch, there's going to be a submission, but it's not going to be a great match. It's not going to be anything amazing. But when you have two great competitors who are very evenly matched and you get one that is a cool takedown and one of them gets a guard pass and somebody shrimps and sweeps, like that to me is an interesting match more so than the mismatch competition or when it ends really quickly. Maybe not always a mismatch, maybe just an aggressive start. I think that they both have a place as far as entertainment value.
Yeah, I agree with you. A great match, I don't care if it's gi, no gi, points, submission, that means a lot. I mean, I can watch a match, you know, me going against Joe, and Joe taps me out in 2 seconds, and you know, submission only, it doesn't make it a better match because Joe got a submission. You know, I got totally dominated. It was a mismatch from the start. So yeah, I just like great matches, and you know, it's funny. You guys know I'm a basically almost 100% no gi guy. Even though, as I did tell Byron, I did wear a gi last week, which is kind of strange. So I got my two times in this year. But
was it for training or was it for Halloween?
You got me there, Joe. You got me. But I did have to pull guard on the street to get a little bit more candy. So, yeah. But I don't, even though I'm a major no gi person, I watch gi just as much as I watch no gi. I just like good matches. Like Byron said, I want to watch a very competitive match against just two very skilled people. It's fun to watch.
Yeah, I agree. And it's not so much about the skill level, although that's important, but it's about the skill level being equal.
Yes.
You know, if you go to those fight to win promotions, they've got kids, they've got blue belts, they've got all different skill levels. And as long as the matchmaking is done well, then it's all entertaining and it's fun to watch.
And they do a great job of matchmaking. You know, and I just like it that, you know, we're talking about this promotion here, but, you know, they do a great job of matchmaking. And then, you know, they make it great. You get to walk out. You know, you're the only person out there. Everybody's watching you. The lights are on you. You know, that's they run an incredible a show.
You know, what's interesting is that they do that walk out with the fight song, and the younger and the lower belted the competitors are, the more it resembles like professional wrestling or boxing. You get to the brown belt and the black belts, and they just walk out and fight.
Yeah. Yep. That is true.
So there are a lot of people that are doing one or the other or both, doing the regular style of tournament with points and doing submission-only style tournaments. Do you guys have any like training ideas or tips for somebody to sign up for one of these?
Train is my number one tip. Just train.
Just train. I think it's important to know the rules and to, if you're going to roll, if it's a 10-minute submission-only match, you should be rolling 10 minutes. And you should put the point system kind of out of your head a little bit. There is value to the point system as far as not getting just dominated and destroyed and out there. But, you know, you should be looking for the submission. You should be avoiding the submission at all times. No points, you need to avoid the submission if you're about to get caught. But, you know, that should be your focus, the way to create scrambles in bad spots, not just recover things. If you're in a bad spot, you create a scramble and you can actually get some offense off of that. I think you need to adjust the way you're training and you're rolling and you're sparring to fit the situations you're going to find yourself in during the match. And they are a little bit different.
And you made a great point right there, Byron, right off the bat. Know the rules. You know, a lot of places are different. Everybody's got little unique rules. And Byron and I, you know, were cornering a guy, Miles, who's been on the show before. And Miles and... It's funny because it seemed like the other guy was going for heel hooks on Miles, and Miles went for a heel hook. The guy tapped, you know, they declared Miles a winner. 10 minutes later, they said, nope, he didn't win, no heel hooks allowed. And in all reality, that's not Miles' fault. That's Byron and I's fault for really not knowing, you know, and to be honest, I feel like I let Miles down that day.
But he had that good attitude of just, oh, well, move on and learn. It's not a big deal.
Yeah. Joe, you'll like this. So, you know, Miles is a guy I've been training with a long time. So, you know, he breezed through that tournament, tapped everybody out, and that was the finals match. So, you know, we figured he got second place. So, you know, Miles is a young kid. You know, here I am, you know, old as can be, and Miles is very young. So we go up to the, I was like, hey, Miles, let's go get your medal and get out of here. Miles goes up to get the medal, and I was like, yeah, Miles Brown, second place, needs his medal. And the lady's like, sorry, you got disqualified. You don't get a medal. I was like, yeah, he didn't win. He gets second, right? And the lady's like, no, he's disqualified. He's out of the whole tournament, doesn't get anything. And I was about to, you know, raise a little fuss. Miles grabs me and he's like, hey, Gary, no big deal, man. I had fun. You know what I did. I had a great time. Let's go. And at that point, you know, Miles is probably 22 years old. And here I am. I think I was probably 48, 49 65. At that time. Byron, you're getting dementia. But, you know, I learned a life lesson. There's a life lesson right there for next week. But I learned a life lesson, you know, from a guy 30 years younger than me who's just a great person.
and the student becomes the master.
There you go.
That's how it is on the mat some days. Sometimes you eat the bear, and sometimes the bear eats you. A wiser fellow once said that to me.
Thank you, Byron.
That Big Lebowski quote just went nowhere.
How you doing there, dude?
Not too good, man.
One of those days, huh?
Yeah.
Well, a wiser fellow than myself once said, sometimes you eat the bar and much obliged. Sometimes the bar while he eats you.
That some kind of Eastern thing?
Far from it.
Oh, I thought I was the wiser fellow.
You're the bear.
Oh, okay.
Oh, man, that's weird. I think you do need to know the rules. If certain submissions are allowed, let's say heel hooks are allowed, you need to know how to defend a heel hook. It would be nice to know how to do one, but absolutely you have to know how to get out of one safely and to avoid those situations. See the setup before it happens. Those are all big deals that I think people often just say, oh, I'm not going to do heel hooks. I'm not going to worry about it. Is your opponent going to do heel hooks? Then you need to know about it and address that. How is it decided if you guys go to a draw? Is there an overtime system where you're starting into certain positions and working from that? You need to drill those positions with your teammates and get really good at those, because it'd be great if you finished everybody in 2 minutes, but there might be a chance you go to overtime and you need to be able to perform in those spots they might put you in.
And I know, Joe, you were talking about the EBI overtime rules right before we came on.
Yeah, you have to strategize and make good decisions when you're playing in that kind of system. I watched a training partner of mine, a brown belt, do an EBI rules tournament in Austin, Texas a couple weeks ago, and he literally dominated the entire match. I mean, if they were keeping points, it would have been 20-5. And one of the positions he had a lot of success with was having the guy's back and having a body lock on. And so, but he didn't get the submission, so it went to the overtime rules, where you can either start with the arm bar, they call it the spider guard, or you can start on your opponent's back. And his opponent got first pick, and he took his back, and he had his back for 2 minutes or so before my friend escaped. And then when it was my friend's time to choose a position, he inexplicably chose the armbar position. And the guy escaped the armbar position in like 40 seconds and won the match. So the other guy got dominated for 10 minutes and then had 2 good minutes and won the match.
Yeah.
Yep. So, I mean, you got to think about it. And my friend, I mean, honestly, he should have chosen the back.
Yeah.
But, you know, he made a poor tactical decision and it cost him the match.
He was probably thinking about, I'll finish this armbar quicker than I finish him from the back, because I've been on his back and I couldn't finish him. But really, you were on his back and he couldn't get you off his back either.
Right. And since the other guy got to choose first and held the back for 2 minutes, all he had to do was hold the back for 2 minutes and 1 second or whatever, you know. But yeah, he decided to go for the submission instead of playing for the strategy, and it cost him the match.
Man, and it kind of makes me think back of what we were talking about. You know, we all have our own opinion of who won. And, you know, I probably, if I would have watched that match, and like you said, your guy positionally dominated for 10 minutes and then, you know, took him, but then, minute and 20 in the overtime, you know, or 40 seconds in the overtime, the guy escapes, you know, even though I'm watching that, nobody submitted anybody. I'm like, hey, you know, your buddy won. But based off of those rules, he didn't win. And it's the rules that are what matter.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got to know the rules you're playing under and play to them.
And practice in them as well. So if he had a lot of practice matches that went to 10 minutes, okay, now we're going to do the overtime system. He had been maybe more comfortable in making a strategic decision in which place to start from overtime in, and made a better choice, or maybe would have had a better armbar from that spot if that was the case. But if you routinely put yourself in those overtime spots, or maybe just do a full style of match, okay, nobody got tapped, now what do we do? Okay, then we go to overtime, we'll have a buddy time it. And just the more of those you would do, of course you'll do better in those style of tournaments with that kind of a practice. So the other topic is, do I need to train for points tournaments and keep score while I'm rolling or training? What do you guys think about that?
Well, let me ask you if you guys have heard this before. I had heard that the point system was based on the potential for your opponent to do damage, or for the potential for you to do damage if it was an actual fight. And that's why back control is worth the most points, because your opponent absolutely cannot strike you if you have the back and you can hit him. Have you guys heard that before?
Yeah, I definitely have. Yep.
I was under the impression like it was the progression towards a submission. Similar idea, getting you in a good spot to be in and avoiding bad spots.
Yeah, so from that standpoint, it makes sense, right? You're looking for the best possible position. So I'll buy it from that standpoint.
Yeah, I'll definitely buy it from that standpoint, too. For me, though, I'm definitely better side mount. That would be my progression to submission and my, you know, part to do more damage. Everybody's different. I remember Ryan Hall talking once that if in a high level match, if you get somebody's back, it should basically be over. And, when I do watch those high level matches, it, you know, a lot of times it is, and I get somebody's back and it just leads to, them escaping. I'm not at that level. And I definitely need to work.
There's a couple of things with that. I think with the high level match, if you have my back, you probably have racked up a significant lead anyway in the process of taking my back. Granted, I could escape. Let's just say the odds are 50-50. You know, you tap me out and the other one, I get out. Even if I get out, then you have the ability to kind of apply the brakes to the whole match. And if you've got an 8-point lead on me or a 7-point lead on me, I'm going to have to do a ton of work in probably a shorter amount of time than I would actually like to have to either submit you or surpass your point lead. And it's almost impossible to do that if your main tactic is to just slow me down. So yeah, by the time you get somebody's back, that person has done a lot of work and a lot of point damage, and it's usually hard to come back from that, even if you don't get submitted from that position.
And if you escape back control, oftentimes it's because you spun into your opponent. Now you're in their guard, which may be where you started before they swept you.
Yeah, then we're going to rack some more points up. Another sweep, take the back, and we just keep going.
Exactly.
I do think that training with points in mind is pretty strategic as far as if you're wanting to compete and to get better at that avenue of jiu-jitsu. The simple example is I'm trying to pass Gary's guard, and he's got, let's say Gary's on his right hip, his right leg's on the ground, and he's got the ability to just more or less stand up. His right leg is free, and he could just kind of do a technical stand-up and just shove me down to my guard. Well, that's a sweep right there. Although it's not super hard for me to just grab his ankle and not let him stand up with that, or maybe just stand up with him to where we're both standing, if I'm not thinking about points, I'm like, oh, I'll play guard for a little while. That's fun. But if I'm thinking about points, that's a mistake. I can't play guard for now because that gives him those points. Same thing when you're, when somebody almost has passed your guard. You can't let go. And when they pass your guard, you have a few seconds to escape right away before they lock in those points. You should be training for that. You shouldn't be just, oh, he passed. No, it should be, he passed, and I got to go right now to establish my guard back or get out of here before he gets his points. I think that those are huge training tools that you need to be doing to help you do better at these tournaments, because points do matter. In a tournament with six opponents or four other opponents, you can't. It'd be nice to submit everybody, but you're probably going to eke by a couple of them with points. And if they're getting points when you could have avoided giving up points, it hurts your chances.
Well, let me pull a Gary here real quick.
Here we go.
Take this off track. Do you feel that you have a better chance of defending yourself in a fight if you have decent bottom side control, posture, and fundamentals, or if you're turtled?
I'd say side control.
I would too. And I think that's one of the issues I have with the points style tournaments. I've heard a lot of coaches say, you know, when they pass your guard, turn turtle. They don't get points that way. They don't get points for passing the guard. Yep. But I would rather, when somebody's passing my guard, I'd rather set up a good side control defense and work from there. I feel safer. I feel like I have a better opportunity to work.
Yeah, I'm the same boat as you, Joe.
Yeah, that's interesting.
We're not very good points tournament player, Gary.
No, but you know, that's before you took us way off track, pulled a Gary on us. I was about to say, you know, what Byron is talking about. The one thing that I let happen too much, I think, just when I'm training, is I do let people pass. I don't fight hard enough for it, you know, just because I'll let them pass, but I'll then do exactly what Joe said. You know, I'm searching for an underhook. I'm searching for a frame. I'm just searching for good posture. And, you know, I will let them pass and then I'll escape, or I'll try to escape. But, you know, I hate those really good, smash people, the grinders that just got great control. And, you know, they pass and, you know, I let them pass because I didn't want to waste all my energy. And the next thing I know, I'm on the ground, you know, just getting smashed for 5 minutes. So sometimes I do think I need to fight a little bit harder, but, you know, I know where you're coming from, Joe. I feel better at that position. You know, turtle, you know, I do jiu-jitsu for fun, exercise, camaraderie, but, you know, I do want that self-defense aspect. And, you know, turtling, if I turtle, I just feel like I'm just going to get a bunch of punches. I feel like I got a better chance of getting up, you know, in that side control.
I think that's just a strategic thing. If you want to do good endpoint tournaments, there's going to be things you do that are not self-defense practical.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Are you covering your face the entire time to avoid punches? Are you?
I wear a mask.
Looking at the referee to make sure that he's not going to drop an elbow in the back of your head like a buddy would. Like, you're going to have to drop some of this stuff to the tournament. The idea of turtle is an interesting concept. I remember Gary and I attended a Justin Rader seminar. He was talking about attacking the turtle position, and he talked about having a match with Ryan Hall, and he said, I knew I was not going to be able to pass his guard to side control. It wasn't going to happen. And he pulls guard on me, and I can't pass his guard to side control. How am I supposed to win this match? And because Justin's a top player. And he said, it was my goal to force turtle position on Justin and on Ryan and attack that. And so
That's right.
As a top player, be ready for that. And you could either try to make them go to turtle or make them avoid turtle, but that's something that's the top player's thing to control or try to control, and then be ready to attack it. And Justin's got one of the best. If you turtle on Justin, he's going to choke you. Like, that's people don't shoot in on him, and they don't turtle on him very well because he's got such a good front headlock. So I just think you play to the rules somewhat. It may not be the best thing in a fight, but the odds are you're not going to be fighting people who are good at jiu-jitsu. Hopefully, you won't be fighting anybody.
That's my plan. I'm not fighting nobody.
Yeah, I run the other way.
Well, guys, that kind of wraps up the main topic of the show as far as submission-only points tournaments, whatever you want to call them, the difference between them, the similarities, how to train for them. A lot going on there, guys. I think it's really kind of the looking at the future. It's another segment of the sport, much like how no-gi splintered off of gi jiu-jitsu, submission only is going to be another segment that you'll have specialists that compete in those that don't want to do either one or the other. And you'll have people that can kind of float around and do both pretty well, or all three pretty well. And those people will continue to be pretty amazing, but probably more and more rare.
Yeah, and like Joe said, you know, we do think of submission only as really rising in popularity lately. But like Joe said, he competed in one 12 years ago. They have been around. It's just seems like they're getting a little more notoriety. And you know, as a sport in a whole, as a sport as a whole, we are getting much more, you know, exposure, you know, on flow grappling and UFC Fight Pass. So it is kind of cool that, you know, more of the masses are seeing, you know, both the point tournaments, submission only, gi, no gi. It's a lot more exposure, you know, which is great for all of us.
Yeah. And one thing I really like is I don't really see anybody in the jiu-jitsu community that's being real adamant about, oh, my method's best, or this style of grappling's best, or this point system is best. You know, we're all under one roof and it's all moving us forward. And I see everybody just enjoying the journey and going forward with it.
Yeah, I like that. Let's just enjoy the journey. Let's have fun.
Well, with that wrapped up, we are approaching the end of the month here, and then the next month is December. It's going to get colder here in the Midwest. The year is going to end, and we need a coach of the year and a blog of the year. And this is basically an essay contest where you write up a little essay about your coach, or you write up a little essay of how a blog has changed what you're doing, changed, you know, motivated you to train maybe. I don't know what it would be. Some great blog or some great coach. Send us to bjjbrick@gmail.com. We'll pile them up in a nice little stack, and then we'll have a group of judges look at them and pick and vote on the essay for blog of the year and essay for coach of the year. Don't just send us a website, say, this is a great blog, check it out. I can't submit that to a panel of judges and expect them to all check out the blog equally. And if you send me your coach's profile, yeah, I'm sure they're great, but I can't submit, you know, a profile on the coach that's on the website to a group of people and have it compete against essays that are stories of how this coach has impacted and changed their life. We need you to write an essay, send it to us. We'll put them in for the contest. It'll be a lot of fun. We did it last year. We gave a coach of the year, made like a nice plaque and mailed it out to the coach. And I actually mailed it out to the student who wrote the essay. They presented it to the coach. It was really cool. Saw some pictures. And that was a great way to reward a great person in the community and recognize their hard work and dedication towards their students. We're looking to do that again.
Yeah, it's a great idea. I really enjoyed it last year. And Byron, now with our Patreon group, you know, I think we should, you know, with our Patreon, you know, private Facebook group, we'd just ask, you know, anybody there who wants to be a judge, and then get their email address and email them out. I think that's a good idea.
We'll do that. So that's Gary. That's awesome. I don't know if there's an easy way for me to email. I'm not the best email marketing guy in the world. But if you are one of our Patreon supporters, you know who you are because you went to patreon.com or you clicked on the link in the show notes and signed up to support us on Patreon, which means that you're like kicking in a dollar or two or three per episode to show us some support, help keep this brick wall plastered together. Now the brick wall is three high. That's a pretty good wall.
Insurmountable.
Can't go over it. You can't sidestep that sort of a wall either. But now that we got a third brick on this thing, you know, really everybody else who's in the Patreon group, they're also bricks. They're big parts that are supporting us. If you're on Patreon and you want to be a judge, which will include a little bit of work, it'll include you reading a bunch of essays and getting back to me about voting for your top three in each category and that sort of thing. Send me an email. Just say, hey, I'm on Patreon. I want to be a supporter because I really don't know how to send out the group, you know, everybody say, hey guys, who wants to do this? And just solicit that way. If you're listening to this, you're a supporter on Patreon, we'd love to have you as a judge. That would be really cool. If you want to be a Patreon supporter, we'd love to have you as a supporter. Not that you could tip the scales as the judge, which I guess technically you could do. But
there's one vote automatically.
We found a loophole.
So if you're nominating your coach, go to Patreon, sign up to support the show.
We just found a loophole in the whole system. No, yeah, I think
we got to do this every week. We'll get more money.
But we'll maybe add a gi patch, BJJ Brick gi patch to be specific, and a BJJ Brick sticker. It will invite you to be in our Facebook group, and evidently you get to be a judge in the contest. I don't think that people will sign up just for that reason.
Oh, I would.
Well, you haven't.
Well, I'm broke.
Because you're working for me. So that's just those things you could do. That's really asking those people to help us out and be a judge. That's really them doing another favor. But that's, we can't have the entire audience be judges. That's just a way to select people who really want the involvement in the show. You guys are welcome to become judges if you're on the Patreon supporter group. Absolutely. Send me an email.
Make sure you tell all your friends about our podcast, BJJ Brick. Tell them about our Facebook page. Tell them about our social media. We are on YouTube. That's probably the one we're trying to grow as much as possible now. We're on Twitter. Definitely check us out on all different avenues. Tell your friends about this Facebook page. Tell your friends about the podcast. We just love it when somebody sends us an email and says, hey, my training partner, Bill, you know, John, Bill, Tom, Roger, Walter told me to check out your had to throw Walter in there, Byron. Had to say, you know, told me to check out your podcast, and I love it. So definitely let you tell all your friends about it, and we really, really appreciate it.
Speaking of social media, if you go to the BJJ Brick Facebook page or the web page, you'll find a series of articles that have been written by yours truly, me. So check them out. You guys want to talk about the last one I wrote?
Yes. Yeah,
I think we should talk about your last one there, Joe.
Awesome. So I've been on a kick lately about concepts, and I wrote a short article and just listed three concepts that I have found to be helpful in my game. And the listeners have probably heard of these three concepts before, maybe not necessarily in this verbiage. I try and put them in language that's easy for me to understand and easy for me to communicate to other people. So the first concept was the Legos concept. And I wish I could take credit for it. I also wish I could give credit where it's due. I don't remember where I heard this first, but there are just certain positions in jiu-jitsu where you feel like things click into place and you've got really good control over your opponent. And I liken that to Legos. If you take two Lego pieces that should fit together, there's 50 different ways you can try and force those things to fit. And there won't be any connectivity if you don't connect them right. But when you get them lined up right, when you get the one side with little pegs on it and the other side with little holes on it lined up just right, and you clip those things together, they're locked in place. Wherever one piece goes, the other one follows. You can twist them, turn them, and they're stuck together. And the position I find easiest to explain this concept is X guard. You've got one foot locked in behind your opponent's knee and one foot locked in his hip pocket, right in front of his hip. I call it the hip pocket, where, you know, the top of your thigh, your hip socket there. And when you get those things lined up just right, you've got complete control over your opponent. What do you think about that, Gary? Have you found that to be true?
Yeah, I have never heard of the Lego theory, but as you were going through it, you know, it really does make, you know, sense. Like you said, complete connection. You take the two Lego pieces that are supposed to fit together, and there's so many different ways to do it. And like you're talking about that X guard, you know, as soon as you do have that position, like you said, you got the one foot in the hip pocket, you know, the other one behind the knee, you know, you just have great control. It's you know, I never really thought of that concept, and, you know, especially the Legos part, but, you know, that's what jiu-jitsu is about right there.
Yeah, if you take that bottom foot that's behind the knee and you if you slide it down to where it's just behind his calf, and then you slide your foot forward so that's the middle of your shin making contact with the back of his calf, there's no connection there. Your opponent can move his leg any direction he feels like it.
Yep. And, you know, I like how you talk about if your feet and toes are curled, you know, it's just, you know, to make that hook, you know, it just even makes it the connection even better. You know, you can just have your foot dangling there, and it's not as great a connection as, like you said, curled, and just makes it even that much more harder for your opponent to do anything.
Yeah, and it's all good until you end up getting like a Blocko or a Mega Tech or whatever, Brick Tech, the off-brand Lego, and nothing fits together.
I hate those off-brand Legos. I mean, they're terrible. The Weeblos or whatever they're called, I hate them.
That's that one long and lanky opponent. You just can't make nothing.
You know, next time we see somebody like that, I'm calling them the Weeblos.
Awesome.
Joe, what's concept number two?
So concept number two is the push-pull concept. And it basically comes down to leverage. But almost every sweep you look at, there's a push and a pull. Take the scissor sweep, for example, and look what your legs are doing. One leg's moving in one direction, and the other leg's moving in the opposite direction. So I say push-pull, but really, it's just moving in opposite directions. Think about a judo player off-balancing his opponent, and you've got a hand on the collar and a hand on the sleeve. And you pull the collar, you push, or you pull the sleeve, you push the collar, and it off-balances your opponent. So there's a million positions in jiu-jitsu you can apply this to, but basically it's a push pull, and it's to off balance your opponent and to keep them so they cannot attack you.
That is a great concept there too. And you talked about the scissor sweep. And Byron, I think back to Byron with that scissor sweep. Byron, you were kind of early in your career. You figured out that scissor sweep. And, you know, like you said, one leg's moving one way, the other leg's moving the other way. And, you know, one thing that Byron used to always stress to me, and when I first started, you know how sometimes your instructor tells you something, but you don't necessarily get it. And you need somebody else to explain it in a different way. And I just remember my instructor showing us the scissor sweep, and, you know, he's saying, hey, one leg goes the other way, this leg goes that way. And I was trying to do it, and I think I had that part down, but I wasn't getting the sweep. And I just remember Byron working on the side with me. And I just remember this, Byron. It was one of the first things you ever taught me really early in our careers is you were saying, hey, if it doesn't work, you haven't off-balanced him enough. Kind of like what Joe was saying. You know, now I need to reach down and I need to pull him into me. I need to pull his upper body and make it, you know, farther off balance so he doesn't have as much weight on, you know, his lower half. And then when I do that scissor sweep, he's going to go flying. And, you know, it's just, you know, push-pull. I'm off balancing him, as Joe said in the article there, and it's making it a lot easier for me.
So you're getting his hips higher than his shoulders, basically, right, Gary?
Yep. Yeah, definitely correct. Yep.
Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. So speaking of sweeps, that brings us to the third concept, which is the compass quadrant concept. And Gary, you mentioned how just one person explaining something differently can turn on a light bulb for you. And that was the case with this one. I was already a blue belt and I could sweep some guys a little bit, I guess. But I was training and I was having problems sweeping somebody. And the instructor said, it's because you're trying to sweep just left or right. And think of it as four quadrants, and whatever post of your opponents that you have eliminated, that's the quadrant you want to sweep them into. So if I'm trying to sweep you to my left, maybe you can get a foot out and sort of base there. And if I keep trying to sweep you to my left, you're going to be able to fight with that foot. But if I've got your arm controlled and I just put you on that shoulder and then sweep you in that direction, it's going to be very easy.
Yes. And Joe, I am going to steal this right here. I am going to, take a picture of this and send it to one of my training partners. And I have never thought about quadrants. I do it myself. You know, I kind of see where, you know, like you said, the guy is overly committed, where he's posting or what way I need to do, but I have never thought of it in quadrants. And I've got a guy that I train with a lot, and he's kind of new and he's really trying to figure out sweeps and everything. And I just don't do a very good job teaching him and talking to him about sweeps. But when I was first read your article here, the one thing, and I hate to tell you, I did not even read this article to today. I know you've had it, so you can choke me out all you want because I did not read this beforehand. But now after reading this, I was like, this is one, like you just said, the light bulb goes on. Just reading this, the light bulb went into my head. And I'm like, man, this is what I do. I never really broke it down into quadrants. And I think I can actually now teach this guy, you know, and explain to him a lot better using the quadrant method. And so thank you, Joe.
Oh, no problem, man. I'm glad I helped.
Yep. Yeah, thank you.
So the idea behind this is that there's more than just take somebody to the east. You might take them to the northeast or the southeast because it's hard to stop all that. Like you said, he can get his leg out and block to the east, but can that leg prevent him from going to the northeast if the north is up by the arm and you have the arm controlled? That is a really good concept, Joe.
Yeah, to me it was a real eye-opening conversation I had with my coach about that, and I appreciated it, and I've tried to carry it forward.
And man, guys, look at that amazing image that somebody has pieced together to go with this article. Joe sends me like these really cool articles, and then I'll like try to produce like a graphic to go with it, and typically it's just the words of the article in a kind of a graphic. But I actually got a picture of a compass and put that on there with some Legos.
You did the graphic, Byron?
Yes, I did, Gary. Aren't you proud of me?
Yeah.
No, I was actually thinking when I read the article, I was like, man, this is the best article I ever read. But man, Joe's really lacking on the graphics. Yeah, that's the worst I've ever seen. But now it makes sense.
It all clicks together like Legos, Gary.
No, really good graphics.
Yeah, man. Right.
Give yourself a pat on the back. No, really, it is.
It does look good. I've commented several times that, man, that Byron makes my articles look good.
Yeah. As long as he doesn't include a picture of himself, he'll make your articles look good, Joe.
That's a fun. It's a good article. It's fun. It is educational, and it is on the BjjBrick website, written by our friend Joe.
And like we said earlier, or Joe said earlier, he has a lot more articles on there. And Joe is a very talented writer. He knows how to get his points across, which is, it's tough to write. You may have the thoughts in your head, but to put them on paper and to make it so somebody can understand it. And what I like about Joe's writing and the stuff he does is Joe's a big concept guy. You know, he's not just talking about, hey, you need to learn a Kimura. Here's how you do a Kimura. You know, Joe's mind is very intellectual, and he's always has these concepts. And yeah, I'm always impressed by you, Joe, just the way you think and the way you can put it down and to make it so, you know, people like myself can understand it.
Well, at least I got one person fooled.
Yeah. At least he read it while we were doing the show.
Hey, I read it, Byron. So there. I haven't seen the Big Lebowski, but I will read Joe's articles. But something Byron asked me to do, I probably won't do.
Well, I didn't expect you to watch a whole movie. Joe, what is happening next week on the podcast?
Next week, we've got my very first BJJ coach, Nick Unander, on. And it was a pleasure talking to him. I hope everybody tunes in next week and checks it out. I was a little bummed to hear that right after interviewing him, he broke his collarbone getting swept during training. But I've been very encouraged to see that he has not missed a beat. I don't know if you guys have been following his Facebook page, but he's been training every day since and just limiting himself and being careful. But, yeah, check out next week's episode and our conversation with Nick Unander.
Definitely get well, Nick, and hope your collarbone heals and you get back 100% back there on the mats.
That's one thing we don't want people knowing is the BjjBrick curse. About a third of people that interview with us break something the next day.
The BJJ BjjBrick curse.
But he's doing great. I'm really impressed by Nick, and it was really fun interviewing him. Joe did the interview. I sat back and listened. I was like, okay, I'll chime in if you need me to. And it was super smooth interview. I was really impressed by Joe's interviewing skills, and I only chimed in for a late inappropriate joke at the end of the interview. Yep.
And then make sure you check out Joe's new adventure, Joe's Better BJJ Brick Podcast. And he just does it by himself, and it's definitely better, as Joe says. So definitely check that podcast out also.
There we go. Joe's got a lot going on.
Yeah, definitely.
Gary, this is the time of the show when you get to talk about your audiobook that you're working on. And this may not make a whole lot of sense because it comes from the movie The Big Lebowski, but it comes from a time when you were in a parking lot of a bowling alley with your three buddies, and you look up, the car's on fire, and there's three guys ready to fight you. One of them even has a sword. It's go time, Gary. What do you do? You have a bowling ball in your hand. How did you deal with these people? And how did you guys survive? Most of you guys survived the situation.
Yeah. Well, you know, this isn't really a technique audiobook like I normally do. But, you know, I'm pretty good out there on the lanes. I'm pretty impressive, to say the least. But, you know, I didn't work out very well that day. You know, what I did is I went into a bowling alley and I tried to hustle some people. And they found out, you know, about it. And, you know, next thing I know, I lost my arm. You know, so I only had one arm. It was, I got it replaced with a plastic arm. And, you know, so then I couldn't be a professional bowler or a hustler anymore. So I went around the United States, mostly in the Midwest, Iowa, you know, up in Amish country. You know, and what I would do then is I would sell, you know, bowling supplies, and I'd go around. And, you know, I ended up making a career, you know, or making some money because one day when I was in a bowling alley, you know, I just heard some guy just throwing perfect strikes. And he happened to be this Amish guy who, you know, would bowl 300 games. So, you know, I just went around the world with him, and I ended up beating Ernie McCracken. I don't know if you guys know who Ernie McCracken is, but I ended up beating him and winning the championship. So, you know, that's my life.
And so what? Did they call you the kingpin?
I was hoping somebody would get what I was doing there. Because I know Byron won it. Do you know where I was going, Byron?
Kingpin.
One of the best movies ever.
Gary.
Yep.
Kingpin's pretty good. You like the Big Lebowski, you would laugh your butt off the entire movie.
The Kingpin is great. And, you know, I mentioned Ernie McCracken for my buddy, Craig Kennedy. Craig, I hope you're listening. If not, I'm going to tell you to listen just to hear Ernie McCracken.
You guys are missing out on a great movie.
Yeah.
Kingpin is good.
So what I would recommend, instead of buying this audiobook, go rent Kingpin. And it's, you know, cost you a couple bucks, but you'll have 2 hours of shenanigans.
Yeah, Gary, people aren't renting tapes anymore, buddy.
Sorry.
You're old.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, just head down to Blockbuster. pick up a VCR while you're there.
We got any Betamax?
Originally, the podcast was Brickbuster, and we went out of business trying to rent movies, so we had to do this instead. But man, Gary, Kingpin over the Big Lebowski. They're both good movies. You like both of them.
Kingpin is great.
Yeah.
Kingpin is great.
There you go.
Yep. Woody Harrelson's best, best piece.
There you go. Undisputed, huh, Gary?
Yeah, Undisputed actually was not. That was with Ving Rhames, by the
way. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
We always advertise, if you're coming through the Wichita, Kansas area, come train with us. We love that, to meet listeners and to get some mat time with you guys. Send us an email, bjjbrick@gmail.com. Joe, if somebody wants to train with you, how could they get this done?
Man, it's a little difficult because I train half of my time in Texas and half of my time in Louisiana. But if you're ever in the Houston, Texas area, take a 40-minute drive south to Lake Jackson, Texas, and train at Brazilian Top Team Lake Jackson with my coach, Fernando Hallfield. And if I'm here, I'll definitely train with you. And if you're ever in Louisiana, somewhere around the New Orleans area, look up a school in La Rose called La Rose Jiu-Jitsu with Buddy Kiff. And if I'm in Louisiana that week, I'll hit you up and we'll train there as well.
Yep. If you want, you could email me at bjjbrick@gmail.com. I'll pass the message along to Joe. Even better, just message us on the Facebook page that we have, bjjbrick, and Joe will see that. And he's quickly becoming the social media guy for the podcast. But Joe should be able to catch those messages if you want to train with him. Should be an easy way to get a hold of him there.
Yeah, looking forward to it. That'd be awesome.
Cool. Had a lot of fun this week. Joe, it was a blast having you on here with us.
Man, this was awesome, guys. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you know, I really like it when you come on there, Joe, because not only do I just get busted on by Byron, you jump on it also. So, you know, it keeps me sharp.
Well, guys, it's been a fun week. Look forward to probably doing this again sometime, getting the three amigos, the three musketeers. I don't know what else you could call us. I'm sure they'll come up with lots of clever nicknames for the three of us, three stooges. But
hey, can I be Mo?
You'll be Shep, Gary.
Okay.
The worst stooge.
You're Mo because you got the haircut.
Wasn't it Mo, Larry, and Curly, and Shep was like the oddball alternative?
Yeah, he was.
See,
when one of them quit or died or something.
Yeah, that's perfect for me.
That's
I'm the oddball
for me. Just because I have very short haircut. I went to my barber the other day, which really I don't have a barber. I cut my own hair, but the joke will work better if I have a barber. I went to my barber the other day, and I said, "Hey, can you cut my hair short up here? A little uneven over here. Miss a spot back here, and kind of nick me on this side over here." And my barber said, "Well, I don't know if I could do all that." And I said, "Well, you did it last week." I got a terrible barber. Anyway, stay sweaty, my friends.
Train hard, train smart, get better.
And don't forget to shower.
Thank you for listening. I hope you find the time today to roll. After all, the best way to get better at Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is to do Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.